there are less than 10 companies in the world that can make the claim to do what I do. You have all heard of 3D printing. What you are likely familiar with is the tabletop versions, where people can print out anything that within the confines of a printer bed, size mostly as long as it's in plastic. I do something very different. I print in concrete, and I print full-scale 3D objects. I spent much of the last year going around and presenting exactly what I'm going to be sharing with you now. We've received an overwhelming amount of press and attention. We have a client list about 100 people deep. The crux of all of this was based on the imminent arrival of our printer, which was on the cusp of being shipped from Italy, where it was being made by our partner, Enrico Dini. In fact, it was boxed and ready to go, but it never left port. This became a soap opera unto itself, but I have to say that after the PR tour, I found myself going on what I like to refer to as my apology tour. A lot of, sorry, I'll call you when we get word that it's en route. So once it became clear that we were having some setbacks, we took a different tact. For one, we spent last year getting to know the industry and who was out there, where it was really at, and not where it pretended to be at. These were steps towards getting to our goal, which is to be the go-to name when one considers building in full scale using 3D technology. And to a degree, that's what we're becoming. But I'll return to this shortly. A little history first. I'm going to take a step back and share with you an abbreviated journey that took me through the new world of full-scale 3D printing and deposited me and my partners where we are today. Being an architect and contractor by profession, and in this case, the client of the project, I'm going to show you why this relationship is essential to move this project forward. I'm going to spend a few moments discussing with you how we got to set the context for full-scale, full-size 3D printing. So additive manufacturing, which is sort of the other name of 3D printing, goes back to the 1980s. In 1984, a guy named Chuck Hull of 3D Systems invented a process called stereolithography. Stereolithography is a process in which layers are added by curing, and it gets a little technical, curing photopolymers with a UV laser. This additive process repeats itself around and around until you achieve a 3D solid. In 1986, he founded 3D Systems Corporation in California, and today, alongside a handful of growing number of companies, produce large-scale 3D printers. One of his other major contributions, if any of you are actually doing 3D printing, is that he invented the STL file format, which we still use. There are a few processes for 3D printing, but the most common one, and the one that you're likely to have heard of, is called fused deposition modeling, and specifically, the type where we extrude heated plastic onto a coated bed. The extrusion process was developed by a guy named S. Scott Crump in the 1980s and was commercialized in the 1990s by Stratasys, one of the current leaders in the field. This is one of Stratasys' machines right here. It runs for about $500,000. It has a build dimension of about a meter by a little less than a meter, three quarters of a meter, by a half a meter, which is large for the industrial design profession, but doesn't approach what we need for the construction industry. It's quite precise. Others have entered the production space as well. We see another machine by a company called 3DP Unlimited, which makes a meter by a meter by a half a meter high. It's much cheaper. It runs about $40,000. So fused deposition modeling is the methodology that has produced Yodas, rain gears, and other things that are called print-in-place knickknacks. It also has famously produced 3D printed guns and knives. You can print in many materials. You can print in ABS and PLA, which are both plastics. And I can get into a bunch of other words, which are just long names of plastics. But the other thing we're looking at is we're printing in nanocarbon fibers, and we're printing in Kevlar, and we're printing in hemp. Does anyone know what hemp is? It's pot without the pot. Cellulitic refuse, which is the stuff when vines fall off of a, when vineyards have finished printing for the season, we'll use vines and we'll turn those into fibers. They're very strong. We've seen it enter all manner of our lives, slowly at first, but it's virtually ubiquitous now. 3D printing food is seeing much progress. This is a printer that was developed by a professor at Cornell called Hod Lipson. The medical field has seen its influence greatly. Here we see artificial legs, which have been produced both for humans and for livestock, and working ears. Dental fillings, are done almost exclusively with 3D printers now. However, the philosophy behind much of this growth, especially as it applies to the consumer and home market, is that instead of going to the store to buy an object made in a factory by injection molding, such as a measuring cup or a funnel, you can print it yourself. I applaud the use of this technology for medical applications. However, printing a custom World's Best Dad mug or my own Yoda is fun, but wasn't going to change the world. Of course, art is always looking for processes to explore, and many artists have embraced this new process to forge their messages. What's funny is that you have a poster in your wall, in your stairwell, with this image. So I just thought that was kind of a coincidence, the same skull. MakerBot, along with the more recently created Formlabs, by the way, you have a MakerBot in your lab downstairs, in the mid to late 2000s became one of the first companies to make this machine available to the consumer. Much the way that Apple brought the PC to everyone on this planet, so too is the goal of these guys. And they spawned nothing less than a burgeoning maker revolution in what stuff people can print from their houses. Our consumer landscape is now filled with machines and their offshoot support systems. They have entered the consumer marketplace and they're now readily available from multiple big box stores. This is a new version from Dremel. Dremel is a big company that does tools for model building at Home Depot, an American big box store. Is it that long before we see knockoffs sold on street vendor stands and flea markets? And as much as a fan of I am of this stuff, and this is a very personal, biased opinion, these are but diversions and toys. The stuff and the detritus that fills our life. Perhaps an analogy is that the MP3 player or the digital camera, in the end, it may be a different delivery system of music or images, but in the end, it's still music and images. However, since I'm an architect and a general contractor, what did excite me was the idea that how this could redefine the very fields of design and architecture and construction. To me, these new processes actually change and alter the way we view the act of designing and building and the way it will be delivered and supplied to us. So about 3 years ago, I went out and I did my homework to see where the industry was at. And modern development and research in this field goes back only about 10 years. In 2004, a guy named Barak Khoshanevis founded the Contour Crafting Project. He's a professor at UCLA in California. And under the university umbrella, he came up with this groundbreaking method for casting concrete in full scale. Excuse me. So he basically uses a giant X, Y, and Z axis machine mounted on two parallel rails that extrude concrete like a big pastry bag in a computer-controlled pattern, extruding up from some flat XY plane. You can see how he lays down the concrete without reinforcing at 1 inch or so intervals and then retraces the prior path. Each time he comes around, it's raised an inch or so. Also important is that the concrete has to be cured sufficiently so that it doesn't crush the layer before it. So he was pretty smart. So he came up with this idea of a trowel, using the mason's trowel. The idea of as he pushes it in, as he squeezes it out, he goes over it again and kind of crimps it. He squeezes it a little to try to tighten it up, which is what a mason would do. The shortcomings of this project are that the process doesn't allow for integrating horizontal elements like roofs and window lintels. He does consider it, but in his model, he accomplishes it through a parallel track, which remains a bit of a necessary complication. To my knowledge, there has been some well-made test sections built, but nothing large-scale has ever been attempted or contemplated. A short while later, another guy enters the field. His name is Enrico Dini from Pisa, Italy, an engineer with a family history of engineers. His dad was the chief designer of an engineer for Vespa. He formed a company in 2006 called D-Shape. Next up was this Dutch firm called DUS Architects, and they began building what's called the Canal House in 2014. It's taking shape slowly but surely. I'm actually not sure if it's been completed. Maybe someone here knows more than I do, but I know that they are not building the building as much as they're building the panel system in the front. So they're building it in a printer called the Camera Maker, which is this guy in here, and their sizes are good size. Looks like about a meter by a meter and a half. Probably it goes up a meter or 2 meters high. Next up is these guys, Germans, the Voxeljet company. Originally, Voxeljet was, they would build molds for the car industry. And they also stepped up in making large-scale printed forms and interiors. They actually sort of have the leading in precision combined with size. So they're doing these incredibly precise things. They remodeled the interior of a chapel, which was LiDAR scanned, and then they rebuilt the chapel elsewhere. And, you know, there's like no downsides other than the cost. Something like this would run $150,000. So it's not practical for construction. But their machinery is exquisite. I mean, if I could use stereotypes, it's German. Absolute precision. I mean, it's a gorgeous, it's a Swiss watch and a German car. But they're too expensive for that reason. And rounding out our original field is a company called Winsun. They made news about a year and a half ago. This Shanghai-based company announced to the world that they had built houses using large-scale 3D printers using a mixture of quick-drying cement and recycled raw material. You can see it's similar to Cushion & Nevis in that it's a slurry of concrete extruded from a printer head. And so the inside gossip is that this community is so small that we know everyone, and we've spoken to all of them. So we spoke to Cushion & Nevis, and he told me that, yeah, I know all about Winsun. He came to visit me, he saw my machine, he went back to China, and he copied it. That's the inside gossip. Here we see how the trusses are being built up. So again, they are building them off-site, and then they are hauling them in place with these bars, and they bring them and drop them on the site. There's Chairman Mark, and there's his assistant Grace, both of whom we know. And this is a close-up of what it looks like. And you know, some people might say, oh, you know, it's so sloppy, it's really not appropriate for construction. But you know, it is what it is. It is the process. This is what you get out of it. This is where we are today. So do I find that, you know, disturbingly rude? No, I don't. It is what it is. Also, gee, I don't know if I've ever noticed this before. You see fiberglass. Yeah, I never noticed, you know, I've never seen that in the photo. So I think what they're also doing is they're adding fiberglass matting. So, you know, what am I trying to say? This is sort of what it looks like, tilt-up construction. So it's not actually cast in place, but it's pretty close to cast in place construction. So, you know, built off-site, brought to the site, put together. Does it really matter? I don't know. They supposedly built 10 houses in 24 hours, each costing $5,000. So that fact, when that was announced, that made it around the planet in about 12 hours. I remain dubious about its veracity of being 3D printed, but it doesn't matter what I think. Because what they did is they put up 10 buildings in one day with minimal labor, and that for a fraction of the cost. So who cares about the details? They did something amazing. And then about 6 months ago, I read about this. Again, to great international fanfare, on the same lot, these actually are within, here's the red carpet, same lot. They built the highest 3D printed building in the world, and the largest 3D printed building in the world. What we also see is, this is from their own photographs, we see that they're using the rebar, they're dropping rebar in manually, and then they're coming back and they're grouting this and filling this together. We also can see from the next shot, we see that electrical conduits are being applied to the ceiling. The ceiling is formed in place. When I look at this, I can see the plywood marks, so you kind of understand that this wasn't 3D printed in the true sense of the word. Anyway, maybe that sounds like sour grapes. It's not, I promise you. I'm pretty amazed by what they do. They, you know, the, here's a you know, the deep, this is what it looks like. And then here we apply the railings, the balconies, the historical, you know, the historical stuff. They dress it up real nice. Now, in the winter of 2013, I tried to contact all of them. No one got back to me, except this guy. So this is my love letter shot to Enrico. I think he loves this shot. This is as good as it gets. I asked my assistants to reach out to all of them. No one got back to me except for him. He wrote me a very friendly email, and we started keeping in touch with each other. And then he said he was coming to America to give a TED Talk. Do you have TED Talks?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, you know, very sort of open thing. So he goes down to Washington, D.C. I go down and I meet him. I show him two projects. I show him my Minetta Lane project, and I show him this other thing I'm doing upstate. The Minetta Lane thing, he says, I can't do that. It's too tall, too big, too detailed. We can't do that. But I could do this thing you're doing upstate. So we left each other very encouraged, and we began a partnership. And shortly thereafter, Enrico, myself, and four others would become New York City partners. So together we formed D-Shape Enterprises, which is based in New York City. We have everything a printing company could want or need except a printer. And that clearly could pose a problem when you're trying to build stuff. So what we had was all the stuff that was on was not, but really prototypers. So I found, so I basically said I really got to go to Italy to see personally what he was up to. And so I got the rare opportunity to go to Italy and call it a business trip. And I found in Pisa, and so here I am in Pisa taking a tour of Enrico's facilities. And what I saw was a bit like Ebenezer Scrooge in A Christmas Carol. I visited three of his machines, his past, his present, and our future together. And his past involved me driving 8 hours to the outskirts of, I don't know where we were. Apparently we were right outside of Venice, to a town called Rovigo, where he showed me his first machine. And it was a bit like looking at Edison's wax cylinder. Everyone get that reference? Everyone know Edison started out with the wax cylinder? It was slow and heavy-handed, but yes, it could make something that sounded like music. I should also state here that Enrico's machine, or our machine, are not the machines that we just saw. They're a very different process. They work by sprinkling salt water onto a bed of sand that's mixed between, that's mixed with magnesium. So this printer is huge. It could do 6 meters by 6 meters high. So in theory, we can print anything that fits within that build volume. So that's 6 cubic meters, 20 feet cubed. That's pretty impressive. The problem is that it's a lot of labor. You still have to, I mean, this is sort of the first machine. So you have to shovel the sand out. This big machine works its way across, smooths it out, and then drops the water on it. It seems really kind of dopey. But like I said, it's kind of like the wax cylinder. It's the start. So we get back to Pisa, and he shows me his current machine, which is a little, he's starting to get his together. He's starting to figure out a couple of the problems. So we're getting a little better. This is like a 1950s high-fidelity stereo. It wasn't an iPod Shuffle, but that'll come. We had a car that drove. It wasn't so fast. It wasn't so flashy, but it got us where we needed to go. However, what I'm expecting to see this summer, I'm going to show you. It's the souped-up version. So in 2008, he patents this machine. Its paper is basically the sand. It's sand mixed with magnesium, as I said, and the ink is salt water. When the two mix, it creates a kind of, it's called magnesium oxide cement, which is a very particular type of concrete. And it's not like we don't have a precedent. In fact, the entire Great Wall of China is made with magnesium oxide cement. And it's been there for a long time, so that's good to hear. It's a very green process. There's no off-gassing. There's nothing detrimental to the environment at all. It is salt water. it is sand, and it's magnesium. Those happen to be, coincidentally, the three most plentiful things we have on planet Earth: salt water, sand, and magnesium. So that's kind of a happy coincidence. Another thing that's different between what we do and what that machine does is that we use a dot matrix type printing head where we have 200 printing heads in a line dropping water. So one of the advantages of our system is that we can produce a much finer layer. We can lay down stuff as fine as 5 millimeters and we'll minimize post-processing. In essence, we drop water down and these little droplets, and then we, as the machine comes back, we kick it over and fill in the gaps. So here's what it looks like close up. You know, we decide where we're going to. So what happens is this thing kind of runs down the line, and when it comes back, it's going to drop water sort of in the missing gap. That's how we create a solid. It sounds terribly crude, and you know it is. It really is kind of crude. You know, it's one of the funniest things. When I go down to see your lab, I'm always sort of surprised when I see this kind of thing. You know, it's amazing to see the high and low technologies coming together. So you have these CNC machines, and you have these routers, and all this heavy, harsh, big, ugly equipment, and then you have these Apple computers sitting right there. So it really, and this is sort of the extreme of that, because you absolutely have the finest and the finest of machinery. You know, you put a drop of water on a computer and you blow it up, and yet you're working with the crudest material there is. You're building in concrete. There's nothing rougher or cruder than mixing, you know, tons and tons of raw concrete. So it's kind of a very interesting methodology. It allows for much finer details. These are sort of ready to print. These are not post-processed, so this is what came out of the printers. This is a model of what was the Radio Lara, which is a thing we printed. I had shown a slide. The first slide I showed of Enrico Dini was him in the base of it. The original is about 28 feet high. It was, until the Chinese built the five-story building, the highest 3D printed object in the world. It also is very good at making flat panels. And here's Yoda again to indicate, oh, I missed it, here he is. Here's Yoda again to indicate the scale of the printed stones. You can see the fineness of the process and what it looks like in a post-sanded model. The methodology is the same one that prints on a standard MakerBot printer. You know, right now we have a very particular type of code. We're trying to go to a standard one that you guys would use downstairs. So in the end, I returned from Italy feeling like I had witnessed firsthand a real shift in the direction of construction and architecture, and came home fully believing in the future of this technology. Today, D-Shape is 8 devoted people, 3 interns, 2 managerial assistants. We have evolved the company, and we are now on the verge of something quite expansive. With all this expansion, it's great, but being a printing company and lacking a printer tends to slow us down a little bit. So, you know, I didn't let the lack of the obvious become a deterrent, and so we push force with plans to make the first project as a company a personal and a special one. Does anyone know who Donald Rumsfeld was? Is? No? He was the American Secretary of Defense. So he famously said, there are known knowns. There are things we know, and there are known unknowns. And that is to say, there are things we know we don't know. And I couldn't have said that better. And so with that in mind, we move forward knowing that the unknowns were really pretty well known and hopefully would become known knowns soon enough. And before I sort of go on to show you our project, I just want to give you a little pictograph of sort of where the industry is at. This is the UCLA professor, 1996. Nothing happens. 8 years. Winsun enters it. Here's my partner, Enrico Dini. Some other guy, he's no longer around. Enrico Dini, D-shape, a couple more D-shapes, and then boom, 2013, I sort of start entering the field right about here. Everyone enters the field. But right now, this is sort of everyone who is out there, and we probably have double that today. This chart was already about 6-7 months old. So it's an industry that is exploding. Yet no one can really print anything yet. Anyway, let's go take a look at what we're going to do with our printer. We arrive in upstate New York to the quiet little village of Gardner, New York. It's known mostly for its climbing. It's the climbing center for the northeast of the United States, and has been that for at least 70 years. Before that, it was just a little farming community. It's located about 85 miles from New York City. It's a very easy way to get there, straight up the thruway. You get off the exit. I'm about a mile and a half, or just a couple miles off the thruway. In the spring of 2012, my wife and I bought a cliffside 5-acre parcel for a very small amount of money, and we both fell in love with it the moment we walked the property. It has amazing views of the cliffs, and we had set out to build a weekend house there. This was about a year before any such ideas of ever building in 3D had entered our minds. Here's the site plan. What we have organized on the site is basically two systems of approaching the house set off the road about 850 feet. A walking path that runs directly up the center of the site is pitted against the winding auto road that follows the contours. Each remaining lobe of space is assigned a program or a use. So finally, we arrive at the pool space. Ultimately, the path ends at the house itself, but really the house is just sort of less a formal house than a series of slices that take up different degrees of enclosure. This is some climbing. I'm not going to get into a long discussion of why the project looks the way it does, but I'll be very short and say that it reflects the way the rocks are formed. And to be a little more literal, we're going to be 3D printing with the rocks that we find on the site. So in a very appropriate way, the materials of the site will be used to form the pieces of the site, which will reflect the characteristics of the site. This actually has a name, and it's called in situ utilization, resource utilization, ISRU. I should also mention, beside the obvious efficiencies this offers, and I've said this before, but it's worth repeating, that it produces no off gases or CO2 whatsoever. It uses completely inert materials consisting of sand, salt water, and magnesium, three of the most common elements found on our planet. The other thing we looked at was the tree canopies. The idea that these two forces will come together and be the foundation for the design. The basic arrangement is to orient four structures around a pool. Each structure has certain requirements. We have an enclosed area for seasonal use. We have a sunshade area here. And we have an entrance piece, and we have a bathroom and changing pavilion. Once the project had been conceptualized and drawn, we're still faced with the rather significant hurdle of getting it approved to be built. So I had to draw it up and convincingly request the local Department of Buildings to issue me a permit, which we did get. And funny enough, we are the first project in America to get a permit to build in 3D. And I thought it was really funny as hell. So basically, you only had three choices to fill out. Type of construction, stick built, panelized, and that says modular construction. And I was thinking, well, it's really none of those. So I wrote in my own box, I wrote 3D printer, I checked it off, and the guy, the building inspector called me up and he said, what are you doing? And I was like, well, just come out to the site and I'll show you. So I met him, I showed him, and he was fine with it. He's like, listen, I don't care, because you're the architect and you take responsibility. So it's all on me. But what's our goals besides giving my kids an extravagant place to splash around? This project will be our working laboratory for our company and its technology. It's our intent to work out the kinks that inevitably will appear in my project at our cost in terms of time and expense. We have set the project into four parts with different challenges for each part, the first being to build a pool. But consider that I view this as a template and a prototype for other types of work. If we can build a pool, then we can begin building reefs and repair bridges and bulkheads and other underwater structures, which we actually do right now. This image is from an artificial reef that we dropped off the coast of Beiran about 2.5 years ago. Then, the thought is that if we can build a pool house, a modest enclosed structure that's a short step to building emergency shelters and low-cost housing units, again, of which there's a low, a huge worldwide need. And by the way, we've already built these structures. So here's a partial image of a bunker that we built for the Italian military. I'm actually not allowed to show you what the whole thing looks like, but take my word, it's a big structure. And finally, if we can then take it to the next challenge and to build relatively flat surfaces such as roofs, shown vis-a-vis carports and these roof canopies, then it's not so hard to imagine building all manner of bridges and multi-story buildings, which, by the way, we've already built. This is a bridge that we printed about 2 months ago in Pisa. I present these to demonstrate that this is no longer simply a wishful fantasy. We are printing these objects right now. This pool project will be what takes us to the next level in developing these techniques for commercial use. I look at this project as using my own resources to further a rather personal goal. However, the world doesn't need, nor should care about, another pool or a pool house. But it does require millions of cheap, affordable housing units. I believe our objectives are fundamentally humanitarian than they might appear on the surface, and I feel obligated to present that perspective. After all, I could simply have installed a cheap, above-ground plastic pool in a weekend, then deal with a multi-year odyssey in pursuit of the greater good. I view this as nothing less than a major shift in the way we think about and ultimately build. I feel that this new methodology of construction is as significant and far-reaching and on par with how the elevator changed the skylines around the world, or how even the automobile changed the way we design our cities. And to bring these images to fruition require real-time modeling. We've made scores of scale models on our small 3D printer of the pieces to both observe and critique how they'll come together and how they'll fail. You know, using Edison's name again, you know, he famously went through 6,000 trials of his filaments before he eventually found one that would work for his light bulb. So we here's our homage to Edison. Of our tests, trials, and examples, we aren't at 6,000, but we're definitely into triple digits. But why print using 3D printing as our primary methodology? Why not simply use precast or standard cast-in-place methods? Our answer is that we can push our limitations of design and execution using this method further and in different directions than any other available today. We can achieve effects of light and transparency and structural gymnastics, fundamental to design, which cannot be done with any other construction method, or at least without incredible expenses of time and money. And it was quite willful to make the work in the order we discussed: pool, pool house, carport, and then house. We began with the pool because it makes the most sense, and we know we can achieve it with what we already know today. Forces are in compression. Water forces from within, soil forces from without, everything's in balance. The trick and next project on the site increases with difficulty as we get out of the soil and we begin taking on challenges such as gravity and tensile loads. The house will be next. Anyway, we hope that we're going to actually, we will be breaking ground in about a month and a half, and we hope that the main house we start by the spring of 2017. We recently were selected a winner of this award called the Architizer Architectural Award, which is a bit funny because it was a category that I think had no entrance. Like, there's only one project on this page other than us that is legitimate. Like, no, these aren't real. These are just ideas. This one is for real. Whoops. This one is for real. There we are. We didn't even come in first place. But, you know, I was mildly amused that we were kind of, there was even a category and we didn't win it. Oh, well. Anyway, the point is, we are getting calls every single day from the press, potential clients, engineers, scientists, government officials, volunteers, everyone. What we're finding is that there's an incredible desire to see this technology come to fruition, and we're now prepared to finally say that yes, the future is now. Images are fun and press is vanity and sometimes business, but we exactly. It took us a while just to get the rudiments of bringing power to the site. We first had to build a road, then we had to build power. Now we have power to the site, but these are done. We then began excavations in September for the footings, but this has slowed down and we had to, because winter, once winter comes in upstate New York, everything stops. But we are back on the site now. We're building temporary structures so we can house the machine. So we're getting ready. And we're diligently tweaking the plans in both plans and model form. While this time last year we had run samples and tests and were fully expecting the machine to be sent out, as I said, it never left town. As I said, we were boxed and ready to go. But like many things, and there's probably a joke somewhere in here, the reason the machine didn't leave Italy is because it was considered a weapon of mass destruction. That's for real. And I had to prove to them that it wasn't. So once this was finally achieved, they decided, the army, the Italian army, said they didn't want to release it. Rather, they wanted to rent it to us. So we were like, you know, no thank you. So apparently, does everyone know Amazon, the company Amazon? Okay. So the head of Amazon is a guy named Jeff Bezos. Jeff Bezos called my partner, Enrico, and said, you know what, I'm having a private exhibition. Only the coolest, newest technologies are going to be there. I want you guys there. So he flew our machine. He airlifted our machine from Italy. He got the army to release it, went all the way out to California. They set it up for a three-day exhibit. We printed some crappy little coffee tables. This is what came out of it. I don't know. That's the coffee table? I don't know. One of these things is the coffee table. And anyway, and then it went all the way back to Italy, and I never got my machine. So I was absolutely outraged about how that all went. But what's important is that we are being put in the same category as the self-driving car, drones, and the future, right? So we are the future. And I think that is pretty cool. So we're talking with Amazon, we're talking with Google, we're talking with everyone. So I think we are on the leading edge. And while back in Italy, Enrico's still making machines. Here's a machine for Spain. That's here, right? I'm not allowed to tell you where it's going, but it's very close to here, actually. And this is a monster of a machine. This is two stories high. It prints things that are, I forgot, 4 meters by 2 meters by 3 meters. I don't know, it's huge. Anyway, we've also made another decision in that we're not going to be a slave to our own technology. We are happy to work with other peoples to be the enablers. We will work with the Chinese, some guy I haven't mentioned yet who's out in the middle, he did something called the Fairy Castle, or Koshinevis. We'll work with all of them. Because here's the problem. 3D printing is at least a three-legged stool, if not a four-legged chair. Without all of these elements, you have nothing. So the first thing we need is material research. You know, what we use is as important as how we use it. Will it be used underwater like we saw? Will it be in the brutal northeast climate or the rather hot and humid environment of Spain or Florida? Will it be a one-story villa or a three-story apartment building? These are the essential questions that have to be figured out and answered, and the materials have to be made specifically for that use. The machinery. Is it the sand deposition system like we use, which is great at making free forms and curvilinear stuff and parametric designs? Or is it going to be something like we've seen over here, the Windsun machine, which is very good at just sort of taking something in the XY plane and building it up? Other items is understanding how to build in 3D, how to design in 3D. Not just simplistic, does it have overhangs, but how do we get doors and lintels, or even how do we take advantage of this technology, like we see here in this. There's no way we could make this in any other medium. You just couldn't do it. So you have to understand what 3D can do for you. Of course, we need to understand the stresses and strains. Who certifies all this? This is a brave new world and has few precedents. There's no testing. There's very little analytics. We're at the very beginning of this. We know how much strength it takes, but we're really just getting started. So far, many people have gotten one of the categories right. Some people have gotten two. No one has gotten all four. That's what we are going to do, because we are uniquely situated to be architects, contractors, designers. We know how to do all of that. So that's how come we, and we also have material scientists on our team. That's how we're going to get it done. As I spoke about the known unknowns, here are a few that remain in the industry that still need to be solved. Reinforced concrete. Until we have reinforced concrete, we're only living up to half of concrete's potential. We've explored using this stuff, which is called helix fibers, which are galvanized metal fibers inserted into the actual concrete, which act as little mini rebars. However, recently, we formed an alliance with a company called Owens Corning. Anyone know them? No? They do fiberglass. They're all over. They're a big presence in Europe, actually. Related to this idea, so these are the problems, related to this idea of building horizontal slabs without supports. Currently, this is problematic, and some solutions have been alluded to, but have been pneumatic ones. In other words, you blow up a balloon underneath this thing as you print. Our current system, which in essence builds in the solid, can do this, but it's really inelegant, because once we, you know, we can build horizontal slabs, but then we have to build it solid and suck all the sand out by vacuums. That's dumb. So we got to figure out a way of working with that. And we also have one of the largest machines printed in the world. We can do 20 feet, 6 meter cubed. But what if you need to build bigger? How do you deal with that? So we're currently working on two things at once. We're working on a rail system, which is just infinitely long. And we're also working on, I'll show the slide in a second. I'll show you the second way we're handling it. Currently, another thing that we're dealing with is site specificity and site flexibility. Currently, we're printing on a flat surface, and then we pick it up and we move the pieces to their final location. That's dumb. What we want to do, and this is what Winsun does, the Chinese company, we could do better. We want to, so here's a very famous architectural company called Gensler. Their solution was having little drones with little pails of concrete, that's a concrete mixer, dropping concrete down a nozzle, you know, so you can place it anywhere. So, you know, okay, it's a good idea, but it's highly unlikely and highly difficult, even theoretically, to make that work, because the tolerances are too great. But I'm not a naysayer. We began conversations with these guys called Caterpillar. They're the biggest heavy equipment operator in the world, and they want to work with us. And we want to work with them because they are good at moving stuff around, and we want to take our 3D printer and stick it on the back of their machine, and then we could print anywhere, any place, any size. And that's sort of where our new direction is going, actually. So why print in 3D printing in the first place? So I'm just going to run through this, almost done. It's a safer work environment. With less people involved in the direct contact with the active building, there's less chance for typical interactions between machines and labor, which is the cause of most accidents. Less labor required, machines substituting for required labor of others. Eliminated are going to be carpenters, floaters, form finishers, and multiple other building tradesmen. Customization for site specificity. Being able to adapt to unique conditions on the fly and insight in one of the great benefits of working in this medium. If we encounter an unexpected site feature, quickly we modify, software change, reflect the issues, and change in virtually real time. More precision in the work. We are now working, we can do 5 millimeters right now, which is the tolerance that the industry has given for concrete. Industry is 1/8 of an inch. 5 millimeters is basically a quarter of an inch. We can now we are working on a process that will get down to the 1 millimeter or less level of accuracy. This is way better than we need in the construction business. At the moment, we are only using what we print. Nothing is wasted. Less material wastage. Cheaper and faster. And of course, there's a saying, is the economy stupid, should be stated. Ahead of any design opportunities is this idea that this thing is way cheaper. How much cheaper? Well, I don't know, because we're just starting. I predict it's going to be 25 or 35% cheaper on my pool, even with all the mistakes I'm going to make, than having another guy come in and do concrete versions. And labor. Labor accounts for 40 to 50% of any construction company's budget. Imagine if you can save 90% of that and then add in the built-in efficiencies that I've spoken about. That means we might be saving 70 to 80% of what it costs traditional construction methodologies right now. I don't know, and how much faster? I don't know. I know we can cast small structures in hours now that would have taken days, if not weeks, to do before. Negative environmental impacts, none. None. There's no trucking used. You can use the stuff you find on the site. As I've said three times, it's only three ingredients and all of them are plentiful and non-reactive. It doesn't run on anything more than a simple welding machine. Most important, perhaps for me, the biggest and most exciting change in all of this is that I think it'll globally redefine what the very meaning is of what an architect is and what a GC, a general contractor, can do in ways that we're only beginning to predict at the moment. Any homeowner could timeshare a machine. Maybe a group of people buy one and split it with its residents. Of course, this is just the beginning, and it develops, and as it develops, we'll collectively learn what we can from this technology. This image is from another company that my partner, whose CEO is working on, called Freescape. This may be a current fantasy, but it's one that's seeing some serious research money put towards it. I'd like to get some work done on my planet before heading further afield, but this image demonstrates the unbounded vision that this technology offers, and equally, how it has struck some fundamental chord of the basic human need to explore the possibilities and limits that this technology can offer. I personally see amazing things coming out of this, and I hope in a small ways that our contributions will add to a healthier, smarter, and more resourceful future for all of us. And I think this technology accomplishes this, and if D-Shape is somewhere in the front line of this phenomenon, we'll be very happy with that. We have learned that 3D printing for the construction industry is definitely here, and we're on the cusp of getting it, and I'm confident that it's going to be real. And the answer to the question that everyone asks me is, when are we getting our printer? I'm going there on July 7th to get tested on it. So I'm going there literally in 1 month from today. And I'm flying back from Pisa on the 9th. And I'm expecting to get the machine by August 1st. And then we begin. And that's it. So I want to say thank you all. It's been a thrilling reason to travel to Europe to spend time giving a lecture on stuff I love to talk about, mostly me. And it's been fun getting here, and it's been a lot of effort to put this together. I don't know if it shows. I hope it shows, but I've been working on this presentation for 3 months. So it's a lot of effort went into this, and that's it. Thank you very much. If you'd like to contact me, there's my contact information. Three companies, one address. And that's it. Do you have any questions? Erosion of the sculpture itself? Yeah, I think we have, basically. It's the composition of the material. So it has less to do with, in fact, I want to answer that in a different way. When we do underwater sculpture, the type of concrete we use gets stronger in salt water. It doesn't erode, it gets stronger. Magnesium oxide cement actually does better in salt water. The problem with the material we use is that it's very difficult to use in the Northeast because of the cold and the warm and the cold and the warm. Have we solved it? No. Yes. Maybe. Probably have to. There are saltwater pools. I don't have a problem with that, actually. But that's sure. And there are again, this is the first pieces. So as we develop, we're going to think about it. But the thought is that if we really can't get it together, we're going to coat it with a clear epoxy coating to make it solid. It's not going to fall apart. It's not going to blow apart. Again, since it's a pool, it's not a lot of stress on the concrete. The water pushes out, soil pushes in. By the time we get to that, I'm hoping we figured it out.
Okay.
Any other questions? Okay. Thank you all. It's been great. Cool. Okay.
Thank you.
My pleasure. Is Laya here? Do you know if she's here?